You're listening to American Medicine Today, presented by the Bonati Spine Institute, featuring the internationally acclaimed inventor of the Bonati Spine procedures, Alfred Bonati, MD. Once again, here are Dr. Bonati and your host, Kimberly Brummel.
Thank you for joining us on American Medicine Today. I'm Kimberly Brummel, joined by my friend Ethan Uecker.
Glad to be here.
And our other friend, Jeff Wagstaff.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
Well, for those of you that have back trouble, that agonizing pain that just won't go away, and you've tried conservative type methods, and you're having trouble walking or even getting out of bed, or you're being told by doctors from all over that you just need to deal with the pain, and that's going to be the way the rest of your life is. You don't have to suffer. And don't let anyone confuse you, which means conning you into thinking only hardware fusion surgery will help. No screws, no rods, no plates, nothing like that should really be in your back. Unless, of course, it's a dire accident where you're left totally ripped apart. Perhaps you may need some of those items, but more likely than not, those items need to remain in your toolbox and not mangled and tangled into your nerves. Check out Bonati at Bonati.com or call 855-267-0482. We have an exciting show lined up for you today. Mm-hmm. We're going to speak with Dr. Marie Claire Arrieta, author of Let Them Eat Dirt, Saving Your Child from an Over-Sanitized World.
I love this.
Yes, and it explains to parents how to keep their children healthy without, of course, being overbearing. Mm-hmm. And then we'll discuss near-death experiences with a physician who claims to have visited the other side.
I'm excited about this
after
one.
Dying on the operating interview. Table. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's going to be one you won't want to miss. And then, of course, you'll hear what's new in American medicine today. But up first,
in today's Back to Life segment, we will talk to a patient of the Bonati Spine Institute who went from living a life that was restricted by pain and discomfort through their journey of finding the Bonati Spine Institute and are now living pain-free.
My pleasure to introduce to the program Margarita Zepis from St. Petersburg, Florida. Thank you for joining us on the program.
Thank you for inviting me.
You're welcome.
I'm just laughing because Kimberly always likes to put a U in it, like Margarita.
Margarita.
Margarita. When you order
Margarita.
The drink, how do you
I
order
know,
it? Do you say Margarita?
I don't drink, so.
Well, that's why. You need to start drinking so you can say Margarita.
Margarita, Jeffis.
How you doing, Margarita?
I am doing phenomenal, thank you. How are you?
We are excellent Good. Today. We need some margaritas at the moment, I think.
So why don't you tell us how you came to be in pain? Uh-oh.
Margarita?
Hello, I didn't hear you. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's okay. How did you come to be in pain?
I can only hear one word. I'm sorry. I'm having difficulties with the connection.
Okay.
Margarita, tell us how you first started experiencing pain.
I started experiencing pain probably 25 years ago. Getting up in the morning was horrible. So it all started then, and it was pretty bad. Really, really bad.
What did you do at that point?
I went to several doctors, and I went through shots. I did therapy. I did all kinds of things, and nothing helped. I mean, every doctor that I visited kind of sent me to a dead-end street saying, kind of like, you got to live with this pain and take this pill.
Okay. Let me ask you, the pain that you felt, where on the body did you feel it, and was it localized to one area, or did it shoot in other extremities?
It was in my lower back, and it will shoot down to my leg. I would have difficulties, like I said, getting up in the morning.
Got
the
it.
Pain was excruciating. I could walk all day long because I'm a very active person. Mm-hmm. But once I lay down, I couldn't move.
Wow.
I couldn't move.
So what did you do at that point? You had tried, you know, your conservative type methods. Did you seek out other medical treatment before Bonati?
I did. Went to several doctors here in the area and seek for assistance. And nobody ever mentioned that there was a possibility to get a surgery.
Got it.
So I had a brother who was very ill to the same condition.
Yeah.
And one of his colleagues mentioned to him about Dr. Bonati.
Okay.
And when I saw the results on him, I said, well, I am doing what you did, because when I saw the results on him, it was just totally amazing.
Sure. Now, obviously, you know, your brother was helped, so you knew, at least in your own mind, you felt like you were making the right decision. What was your experience like when you stepped foot into the Institute?
When I stepped foot, I'm sorry, I did not hear the last words.
Step foot into the Bonati Institute.
It was amazing. It was amazing. Sure. I felt so welcome. First of all, you get all welcomed by this concierge, which mm-hmm. is incredibly friendly. And then they knew part of my family, so mm-hmm. the tights were right there.
Sure.
The nurses were so friendly. Everybody was so nice. Then I had a primary care physician over there that mm-hmm. kind of like see you before Dr. Bonati.
Correct.
They evaluate you. Mm-hmm. But it was amazing. It was absolutely amazing.
Now, the actual evaluation that you had with Dr. Bonati, what was that like?
It was phenomenal because he came after all the MRIs were done mm-hmm. and he immediately looked at my problem and he said, yeah, this is what's wrong with you. And I'm like, and how come nobody said that before? And he just made me so comfortable, mm-hmm. so comfortable having the surgery because everybody's always so worried about having a sure. procedure in their back. But he just made it like it's just a simple procedure, very, very, very comfortable. He had other doctors with him, so mm-hmm. it was great. It was great. It was a decision that is, you know, it's your back that you're yes. going to make a decision on. Mm-hmm. But I didn't even think twice about it.
And so, Margarita, going through that evaluation period, we hear it time and time again from all the patients that mm-hmm. we speak with that, you know, like you just mentioned, when you come into that sort of situation, you know that it's your back. Everybody knows you don't mess around with your back, you know, because there are a lot of hacks out there, too. So thankfully, you found yourself at the Bonati Spine Institute, but I'm sure they gave you a game plan of what was going to be done. So that set your mind at ease?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And then when they tell you that downtime is so little and all the confidence they put in you, it's amazing. It's okay. amazing. I wouldn't think twice about it. It's like you said, you hear all the stories mm-hmm. about your back, but the procedures correct. They have at the Bonati Institute, it's amazing. It's amazing. Not just the doctor, but the nurses, mm-hmm. when you're there, the day of the procedure,
sure.
afterwards, the guy that calls you the next day mm-hmm. And see how you're doing, Eric, the guy over there that yes. does all the phone calls, the nurse, mm-hmm. it's just amazing. So I didn't just have one procedure. I had two in my lower back and two in my neck. So okay. I had several procedures there.
Sure. And we all know that they're done incrementally. But each time that you had the surgery, when did you notice the eradicating the pain that you were targeting at that time? Because each one's incremental based on the area they target first.
Absolutely.
So
my back was, when I left, before I leave this, when you leave the surgery, you go back to the recovery room.
Sure.
He makes you get up and mm-hmm. he makes you do, you know, walk around. And uh-huh. it's like, my goodness, I just have back surgery. What is this? It's amazing. It's immediate.
Uh-huh.
It's amazing, especially the one with my neck.
Okay.
Where I had this continuous itch in my arms.
Yes.
And nobody could pinpoint that until Dr. Bonati did. She mm-hmm. said, it's your neck and this, this, and this. And mm-hmm. Immediately out of surgery, I had no itch in my arm. I mean, it was right there.
Now, did you watch your surgery?
Yes, I did.
What did you think?
Amazing. Yes, I did. I walked into the OR room mm-hmm. and you sit in this kind of interesting looking bed and
right.
there's cameras all over the place and mm-hmm. they talk and Dr. Bonati continually asks you, is there pain? Do you feel this? I mean, you're right. totally aware of what's going on and you mm-hmm. see it. That was pretty cool.
That was
very amazing.
Did it put you at ease? Because what he does is drastically different than other facilities where they put you under general anesthesia. So did you feel more confident?
I felt uncomfortable at all. Mm-hmm. I felt very comfortable from the beginning, mm-hmm. from stepping into the OR until the recovery room. No time I felt lost or anything. Mm-hmm. No, they were asking me specific questions because
yes.
he's working in your back and yep. he could tell you, do you have pain? Do you feel this? And you feel it. And mm-hmm. but no, I never felt it.
And when they were asking you those questions, do you remember them asking you to try to recreate your pain on the table to try to move around so they could see if they had gotten your pain?
I could not move because I was facing down. I could not move, but
okay.
I could. I mean, my face was facing down looking at a bunch of screens, so I...
Okay.
It was just on the way out of the surgery when I came out of the surgery.
Okay.
They asked you to walk.
Okay.
Well, explain what you mean by that, Kimberly.
They do that too. Sometimes they won't have you like stand on the table, but they'll, depending on where it is with your back, they'll make you kind of get up and try
do the sort of
to
things
move
that
around.
Did
and,
cause you pain when you did that prior to the surgery to recreate?
No, I
your
got
pain.
Up from the bed of the recovery, get up and walk, and I had no pain. No pain whatsoever.
There you go. You couldn't state it better than that.
No,
so,
zero. I could never get up from bed, ever, for 25 years.
Wow.
In less than 15 minutes. Okay?
Wow.
I have to curve myself, put myself in fetal position, then say, for about, 7-8 minutes, and then all crunched up, get to the shower. And here was get up, and I got up. So that's the amazing part. It's just an immediate result. It's amazing.
Fantastic.
Margarita, after everything you've experienced, if you knew someone else that was in pain or suffering like you were, would you be comfortable, as your brother was, referring you to the Bonati Institute to refer friends, family, people you work with, also to the Bonati Spine Institute?
Absolutely. I wouldn't think twice about it. I even tell people my story. I tell a lot of people my story, and they can't believe it. And I tell them, you know, you got to, you know, they tell me, oh, they told me there's no surgery. You got to go and see Dr. Bonati. You have to see Dr. Bonati. You have to go to the Institute because they do have answers for you. They have answers for you, and they have solutions, which is the most important thing.
Continued good health. Thank you so much for sharing your story with us.
By the way, Margarita's story will be featured on an episode of the television version of American Medicine Today. And,
that was exciting when they came over and they were amazed and all the things I can do now that I couldn't do before. So I hope you guys get a chance to see it.
Well, tell us, can you quickly summarize what some of those activities are?
First of all, like I said, I couldn't, every time I went to the doctor and they put me in a doctor's table and he'll tell me to whatever he was checking on me and get up, I couldn't get up. I had to call for assistance. Or after an MRI, after before I went to the Dr. Bonati Institute, I could not lift up myself from the table. I have to crunch up myself to the side, and that would take about 15 minutes for me to get up.
Yeah, so drastic change, for certain.
Horrific, horrific, horrific pain. Camping was unthinkable.
Yeah.
Unthinkable. I could never think of sleeping in any other bed than mine. I slept in on one of those electric beds that you have to feet up and your back up, kind of like in a sitting position all these years.
Do us a favor. Make sure when you are out and about and doing all those fun activities, send us photos. We love to see our patients regaining their strength and getting back in motion.
Absolutely. Look at the show. When you see the show, it's the part that is amazing because when I came home, after being in recovery in my mother's house, and then I was getting to go to work, when my partner saw me get up from bed, he was in shock. He's like, oh, I can't believe this. It worked. I said, of course it worked. I got up, jumped from the bed, and went into the shower in 1 second. So it's amazing.
Well, you are living proof that the Bonati spine procedures are tried and true. Thank you so much for sharing your story
of recovery with us.
You're
very welcome. You're very welcome.
God bless.
Have a great day,
bye-bye.
Margarita.
Thank you. Have a great day. Goodbye.
You too. Bye-bye.
It's stories just like that that make everything that the Bonati Spine Institute does and provides worthwhile. Make sure you check them out at Bonati.com. Make sure you stay tuned because coming up after the break, you'll hear more.
Revolutionary in his field, Dr. Bonati created, perfected, and patented the Bonati spine procedures. Using his genius, Bonati invented precise tools necessary to minimize surgery, scarring, anesthesia, and recovery. So successful are the Bonati spine procedures, they consistently reflect 98.75% patient satisfaction. 50,000 successful procedures have been performed exclusively at our location. Over half our patients have suffered from failed back and neck surgeries at other facilities. Bonati succeeds where others fail.
You're listening to American Medicine Today, presented by the Bonati Spine Institute, featuring the internationally acclaimed inventor of the Bonati spine procedures, Alfred Bonati, MD. Once again, here are Dr. Bonati and your host, Kimberly Brummell.
Thanks for joining us on American Medicine Today. I'm Kimberly Brummell, joined by my friends Ethan Uecker.
Glad to be here.
And Jeffrey Wagstaff.
Hello.
Now, new parents often wonder how they can best strengthen their child's immune system early in life. And joining us right now is Dr. Marie Claire Arrieta, and she's author of Let Them Eat Dirt.
I love it.
Saving your child from an over-sanitized world. Thanks for being here, Dr. Arrieta.
Oh, thank you for having me.
You know what really drew me to this book was just the title, because it really encapsulates my father's parenting style. It was always kind of like, I won't kill him, just let him do it. You know, if he wants to eat dirt, go ahead. He wants to stick a knife in the socket, go ahead. It's not going to kill him. Do you tend to agree
nothing like reading something that sort of reinforces your parenting habits, right?
Exactly. And my dad always said that it's good for the immune system to get some of those germs and things into your body.
And where did
I don't know about the microbes and the knife and the socket, but he was right.
So where do we ever come up with this antibacterial soap and your kids have to live in a sterile environment, put them in a bubble? Where did all this come from?
It ruins the microbiome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know what? It's, in a way, it's our own fault as scientists, because since we started studying microbes, we mainly focused on the ones that cause diseases, right? So we gave them a bad rep. Okay. So in a way, it's a little bit of our fault. But no one really knew until really recently, and we're talking about 5 to 10 years, about the crucial health-promoting roles that our microbes have in us.
Right.
At least our scientists didn't know, right? So because of this, most people, the word for them, the word microbe is pretty much the same as disease. We avoid all germs, and it's almost our innate nature to get rid of them. We're all taught to do that.
Right. The cleaner, the better.
Yeah, that's what we
exactly
what we think. But we've been talking a lot on the show about the microbiome and are just starting to realize how important that is. And you say in your book, Dr. Arietta, that it actually can start at conception.
Oh,
trying to build that microbiome.
Yeah.
Describe that.
So basically, when we're inside of our mother's womb, we're sterile. We do not have any microbes. However, the microbes in our mother's gut, they produce a ton of substances and compounds that are in her bloodstream, and they affect the fetal development. In particular, it's known that they affect the immune development of the fetus. So that's one way that it can affect. But another fascinating thing that we're learning is that the microbiome of the mom changes as she increases weight during the pregnancy.
Okay.
And this is really neat. In the third trimester, when women, we get, you know, fairly large, our microbiome changes so that we gain weight to, you know, at the time that we need the baby to grow and at the time that we need to save some calories for the breast milk and so on. And microbes help doing all these things. But the issue is that if we gain a lot of weight towards the end of pregnancy, we harvest some microbes that are just too good at making us gaining weight. And we can inherit or transfer those microbes to our babies when they're born. And there's very strong science telling us that because of those microbes, those, you know, really good microbes for gaining weight, we can give them a higher risk to become obese later on. And this is after controlling for things like, you know, the mother's weight and the diet and things that we already know that will affect a kid's risk to become obese later on. But the microbes in the mother during pregnancy also come and take a part into this equation.
And forgive me if this isn't your area of expertise, but do we see that more in women that get gestational diabetes or get diabetes that sticks with them for the rest of their lives?
Well, there is...
In their children, I'm asking. Right.
There is an association between the weight gain and gestational diabetes later on, yes. And, and those women would be at a much higher risk of not just gaining weight, but harvesting some of these microbes. Yeah.
Okay.
Dr. Arietta, is based on what your earlier statement about the nutrition and what's in the mother's gut late in the pregnancy, would then probiotics be a positive to take for a woman in her final trimester to benefit the child?
Yes, but not necessarily for that reason. So if you're increasing your weight a lot, probiotics are not going to prevent these particular obesogenic, we call it obesogenic microbes from taking, you know, camp in your gut. What probiotics are really good for, and this is another thing about the microbiome during pregnancy, is for your vaginal microbiome. So if you think about it, when babies are born, they're going to go through the vaginal canal, and that's going to be the first source of their microbes in life. Like the first batch of microbes comes from there. And if there is an unbalanced vaginal microbiome, the baby's not going to get the best type of microbes coming from that source.
Okay.
And it's been shown that if you take probiotics during pregnancy, that helps to balance the vaginal microbiome.
Interesting.
Okay, so that could help.
That's right.
Hmm.
Now, very quickly, Dr. Arietta, you also hit upon a few different parenting decisions in your book, like should I have a pet? Should I give my child antibiotics? Should I let him play with my friend down the street who is sick? What are the answers to some of those questions?
Well, the dog answer, yeah. I mean, of course, this shouldn't be a reason to get a dog. You should be a responsible dog owner. But yeah, interesting is that a dog, but not a cat, will decrease the risk of a kid developing allergies and asthma. And a really interesting scientific work showed that this is because the microbes that dogs bring into your home, so they're literally bringing the outdoors into your home, and that's helpful. In regards to whether your kid should play with a kid that is sick, there isn't like a black or white answer there, because even though we should promote what we call a healthy exposure to microbes, because that drives health, we shouldn't really be exposing our kids to disease-causing microbes, because it's been shown that does not drive health. It does the exact opposite. At the same time, kids getting sick with a common cold, that's just part of normal childhood. If you try to avoid that kind of exposure, you would have to put your kids in a bubble. So if you're just trying to prevent that at all times, you would most likely end up preventing just all microbial exposure in general. So no, you shouldn't be giving your kids, you know, chicken pox on purpose, but it'll be really hard to prevent them from getting a cold from another kid, especially now when they're in school, right?
Yes, yes.
Exactly.
Good advice. Dr. Marie Claire Arietta, author of Let Them Eat Dirt, Saving Your Child from an Oversanitized World.
More information can be found at letthemeatdirt.com. Thanks, doctor.
Thank you for having me.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Some good advice.
Very interesting segment. Yep.
I swear to God, my father, he used to say, to this day, he still, I talked to him like a month ago, and he goes, you know, people talk about how everything has to be clean. He goes, I'll wipe down the table, and then I'll drink the juice from the washcloth.
No,
I mean, he's being crazy.
Oh,
but
Papa Euchre.
He would never actually do that.
Papa Euchre.
No way.
But that's his mentality, you know, like the more disgusting things he ingests in his body.
That's just guy talk with his son.
The healthier he's going to be.
I can hear Ethan having that with his future son someday.
Well,
go ahead and eat that dirt.
Talking about things working in the body or not working, if you suffer with neck, back, sciatic pain, RSD, migraines, there is help. Reach out to Bonati at Bonati.com, and heck, like us on Facebook. Make sure you stay tuned, because coming up after the break, you'll hear more.
Revolutionary in his field, Dr. Bonati created, perfected, and patented the Bonati spine procedures. Using his genius, Bonati invented precise tools necessary to minimize surgery, scarring, anesthesia, and recovery. So successful are the Bonati spine procedures, they consistently reflect 98.75% patient satisfaction. 50,000 successful procedures have been performed exclusively at our location. Over half our patients have suffered from failed back and neck surgeries at other facilities. Bonati succeeds where others fail.
You're listening to American Medicine Today, presented by the Bonati Spine Institute, featuring the internationally acclaimed inventor of the Bonati Spine procedures, Alfred Bonati, MD. Once again, here are Dr. Bonati and your host, Kimberly Brummel.
Thank you for continuing to listen to American Medicine Today. I'm Kimberly Brummel, joined by Ethan Euchre.
Glad to be here.
And Jeff Wagstaff.
Thank you for having me.
Now, regular listeners will know that we find near-death experiences fascinating. And joining us right now is Dr. Rajiv Pardi, a world-renowned cardiac anesthesiologist and author of Dying to Wake Up, A Doctor's Voyage into the Afterlife, and the wisdom he brought back. Thanks for being here, Dr. Pardi.
Oh, it's my pleasure to be here.
Yeah, as you mentioned, Kimberly, I particularly, I know you're interested in this too, but I've been reading about NDEs since like Dr. Raymond Moody's book that came out when I was a teenager. So I've just been obsessed with these things.
Yes.
What I found interesting about your story, Dr. Pardi, is that prior to your near-death experience, you were kind of a jaded doctor, lost a lot of your compassion for your patients, got caught up in the materialism of being a successful physician. Kind of take us back to that time and your mindset prior to your NDE.
Yeah, that's so true. You know, before you know, when I was 17 or 18, then I became a little spiritual and I wanted to go to medical school to serve the poor in the villages in India. But after I finished my medical school, I came to America. My sister was here in 1982, about 34 years ago. And then the spiritual Rajiv who wanted to serve the poor was left behind in India, and I was stuck by the American dream. And my American dream, success, materialism, became very important. It became a runaway American dream.
Okay.
Expensive cars. You know, like I actually, I don't think it is in the book, but I did two residencies. I did a residency in pediatrics, but I was not making enough money because pediatrician is the lowest paying specialty in U.S. Then I did another residency in anesthesiology.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it has a...
Materialism became very important for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, how long did it take before you just decided that having money, having nice cars, having all of those things was the most important thing versus actually caring for your patients?
Yeah, you know, like, technically I was very good with my hands. You know, part of anesthesia is technical, so I became the chief.
Okay.
But I didn't have the empathy. I had a huge pain practice too. You know, the patient were profit points or profit centers rather than being treated as a fellow human being. Mm-hmm. And I built a very big house on a golf course and a lake. I had a BMW, sports BMW, and a Hummer.
Right.
And all that changed after my near-death experience.
Wow.
But before that, it was, as they say in America, keep up with the Joneses. Something like that.
Exactly. Well, why don't you tell us what brought you to the emergency room on Christmas Day of 2010?
I'll just give you one-line background. In August of 2008, I was diagnosed with prostate cancer, and I had a radical prostatectomy.
Okay.
And one of the biggest complications left me was incontinence.
Okay.
And to correct that incontinence, then a doctor at UCLA implanted an artificial device, a urinary sphincter. And that got infected with very high fever, going into blood infection.
Oh, wow.
And that can go into sepsis and sepsis shock, which can be fatal.
Yes.
So during around Christmas, they had to do the surgery to take the device out and clean me up.
Wow. And so what happened to you in the emergency room? Is that when you had that near-death experience?
No, I had it in the emergency surgery.
In the emergency surgery. Okay.
Yeah. Now, another thing that was interesting, Dr. Pardee, is that you're an anesthesiologist and a lot of people, before we even get into your tale, a lot of people blame the NDE experience on the anesthesia itself. What is your sort of professional opinion on that?
You know, actually, there is a drug called ketamine,
which Special
is actually classified as a dissociative anesthetic.
Okay.
It is rarely used in adults, but it can give kind of out-of-body experience, and mainly it is used in veterinary medicine or in children's for bone dressing change.
Hmm.
Yeah, I have heard of that.
And some people talk about DMT also or hypoxia. But the main thing what I have learned is how it changed the person. Did it have any lasting effects?
Right.
Just going to Peru or taking ayahuasca, you know, like all these things, did they change the person?
Dr. Pardee, take us back, though, to that emergency surgery. We're very interested in hear the story of the near-death experience. Tell us how that unfolded.
Yeah, so, you know, I had seen the clock when I was being wheeled into the operating room. About 20 minutes into surgery, I found myself floating near the ceiling, and I was shocked, you know, what's going on? You know, I could see myself, I could hear the talks, and I even heard the anesthesiologist tell a joke. It was a dirty joke. I still remember it.
Oh, wow.
But I can't repeat it here.
It's a family program. Yeah.
Yeah. And part of it, you know, like of job of anesthesiologist is to keep the room entertained.
Right.
And from there, you know, first I thought maybe he used ketamine, you know, but there was no reason to use ketamine or any anesthetic drug which causes dissociation.
Okay.
And I checked the record later. And from there, my consciousness went to different realms. Like, you know, it went to hellish realm, went through a tunnel. I had a review of my present life, review of past lives. Then I was born and raised in a Hindu family, but I met two archangels, Michael and Raphael. So this was the, you know, and when I told my wife about it, and she was surprised, she said, what happened to the thousands of Hindu gods and goddesses? None of them showed up, you know.
And did these angels identify themselves as angels, or you just kind of knew it was, you know?
I knew about angels. They looked like angels with wings and everything and different colors, and they identified themselves too. It was all telepathic communication.
Mm-hmm.
And it made total sense to me later because Michael is the angel of strength.
Mm-hmm.
And Raphael especially is angel for healers and for patients who need healing.
Okay.
But nowadays, my favorite angel is Gabriel, you know, who's making my interview books and everything possible.
Hmm. And so you start there, but then you also go on to explain kind of being at the brink of hell.
Mm-hmm.
How did
the angel came afterwards, you know. First,
okay.
I was in the operating room, then I saw my mother, and then I went to the hellish realm.
Okay.
And describe that for us.
You know, the hellish realm was very dark. There was thunderstorm, lightning, and I could hear different souls being crying, and, you know, you could feel pain. I could feel pain, you know, like there was bad smell also, you know, like burnt meat, not barbecue, but burnt meat.
Right.
And my first reaction was, why am I here? What have I done? You know, having grown up as a Hindu, you know, but the karma.
Yeah.
And I was given the understanding that so far I had led a very selfish life. And it was all about me. I didn't mind stepping on people's toes to get ahead in life.
Okay.
So, and I asked for help. And the person who showed up was my father, with whom I had a very complex relationship.
Hmm.
He was physically and verbally abusive to me.
Got it. And he was kind of your guide at that point?
Yeah, I realized that he did love me, but he had his own problems from the partition of India, because there was genocide between Hindus and Muslims, on the either side of the border.
Okay.
Now, Dr. Pardee, I know there's a lot of details in here, and people are going to have to probably get the book if they want to get the whole thing, because we're on time constraints. But let's jump ahead a little bit. So the archangels that you met, Michael and Raphael, they took you in front of sort of a being of light?
Yeah, you know, they guided me, and we floated towards a being of light. The light was like 1,000 suns, and it was not hurting. I felt like I was a part of the light and separate from the light at the same time, like an ocean and a wave.
Oh, wow.
And that's where I got the understanding my life will be spared, but it will be leading a totally different life. Like, I'll give up anesthesiology. I saw myself there speaking to people, which was never in my wildest dream even. You know, as an anesthesiologist, as I say, I used to put people to sleep. Now I help wake them up.
Dr. Pardee, as someone who grew up with the Hindu religion, after experiencing what you're telling us about now, what are your spiritual beliefs, and do you follow any religion?
You know, I don't call myself religious anymore. I follow universal spirituality. And I have what I came up with, seven truths, eternal truths, as my near-death NDE manifesto.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the major things is we are all connected to each other, and the basis of reality is pure unconditional love.
That's a great...
And then there are other truths, you know, people can read in the book or on the internet, that there are higher beings like angels, ascended masters, who are there to help us.
That's a great message. And again, people need to go out and get the book. I could talk to you all day because I have 1,000 questions, a million questions.
Yeah.
One quick thing before we let you go that I thought of as you were bringing this up, and I knew we were going to have to call back to it. That dirty joke that you heard being told while you were out of your body, were you able to verify that joke was told and that it wasn't just a hallucination? So,
The anesthesiologist did verify that he did tell the joke.
There you go.
He said maybe I was light in anesthesia, but I was not hurting. So if I was light, then I should be hurting.
I gotcha. Wow. So, but in your opinion, you were out of your body and you did hear him tell that joke. That's very interesting.
That's my opinion, you know. Okay.
But too, if you were kind of floating above, you could tell people what they look like, different things that were done. It should have all been verified.
Let's see the whole surgery and everything.
It's interesting stuff.
I love this.
Thank you for sharing your story with us.
Yes. Thank you so much, Dr. Rajiv Pardi. World-renowned cardiac anesthesiologist and author of Dying to Wake Up, A Doctor's Voyage into the Afterlife and the Wisdom He Brought Back. Thank you so much for sharing your experience with us.
Thank you. It was my pleasure. Okay.
Right, take
care.
Have a great day. Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye.
I guess we should say former anesthesiologist.
I know.
It's crazy. Now he travels the world spreading
like
his message.
Said,
gave up his whole
waking people up to the reality of the afterlife. Absolutely.
Good stuff.
Make sure you stay tuned because coming up after the break, you'll hear more. You're listening and watching American Medicine Today.
Revolutionary in his field, Dr. Bonati created, perfected, and patented the Bonati Spine procedures. Using his genius, Bonati invented precise tools necessary to minimize surgery, scarring, anesthesia, and recovery. So successful are the Bonati Spine procedures, they consistently reflect 98.75% patient satisfaction. 50,000 successful procedures have been performed exclusively at our location. Over half our patients have suffered from failed back and neck surgeries at other facilities. Bonati succeeds where others fail.
You're listening to American Medicine Today, presented by the Bonati Spine Institute, featuring the internationally acclaimed inventor of the Bonati Spine procedures, Alfred Bonati, MD. Once again, here are Dr. Bonati and your host, Kimberly Brummel.
Actually, Kimberly Brummel on the line, live from Hawaii. That's how dedicated she is to this program. Girl is on vacation. It's what? Is it like, I don't know. It's super early.
Very early.
That's what we know.
7-something in the morning, yeah.
Yeah.
Couldn't wait to be part of the show and was upset that you guys are going to be able to do this all without me.
I know. I just couldn't believe you're going on vacation and you requested that we call you because you wanted to talk about the election. But that brings me to the fact we normally do What's New in Medicine Today, but Jeff, in lieu of a Trump victory, wanted to do a special version.
Let's talk about what's right in America today, Dr. Bonati.
Let's look at What's New in Medicine Today, featuring Alfred Bonati, MD.
So, Doc, you must be pretty pumped up, of course. I kind of want to get both of your guys' take on what you were doing at the time. Obviously, it was a shock to the nation. You guys, especially you and Kimberly, have been shaking the pom-poms all along, as I like to say, for Trump, cheerleading for Trump. So it couldn't have been as shocking to you guys, right?
Yeah, I called her around 3 o'clock in the morning, and she was jumping all over and screaming. So I knew that she was totally... And after that, she was unable to talk.
Right.
So she lost her voice.
That's right around when your voice went out, wasn't it, Kimberly?
It was. It was just such a fascinating evening because it was something that was so crucial for our country. And to have read all the newspaper headlines and see all the voter fraud that was out there, we believed he would win, but it's totally against all odds. So all of a sudden, when you saw things were close in the highly Democrat states, it was like sitting on the edge of your seat, biting your fingernails, like, he's got to get it. He got, North Carolina. He got Ohio. He got Florida. And I was watching like a point something swing each way. And I was like, oh, God, please, please don't let anybody tamper with the votes are in.
You know what I thought was interesting is that we're based out of Tampa, Florida, of course, heard all around the state. Hillsborough County, where Tampa is located, what are the figures? Do you know what I'm talking about, Jeff? It's like 11 of the last 12 elections, however Hillsborough County went, so did the nation.
And that was true.
It was true until this one, because our county was the majority. Hillary won our county, and yet Trump pulled out the victory. So,
you know, Kimberly, you said something that I think you really hit on something important when you said against all odds.
Yeah.
I'm not sure, though, if that's accurate. Because
but it was, because you had the liberal media set up to make him foul, and it didn't matter what feat he made, how many people were at his rallies, they would only zoom in on him, maybe show a few. If by chance you found somebody at one of these stations that would allow the true Trump experience to happen, you may see the crowd. But overwhelmingly, every other station was dead set against him. They didn't want him to win. They were all in the bag for Clinton.
And that's kind of my point.
They would conveniently forget what Bill Clinton did, and he would still be part of it, regardless of the fact that Hillary would win. Everyone's like, well, so what? It's not about Hillary. Yeah, but her pervert of a husband would have been in tow.
I think the reason that we all believed it was against all odds was because of the spin that the media put against it. Every single television outlet, minus Fox, didn't give Trump a chance. The pollsters didn't give him a chance, which proves that they don't really have a clue what they're doing.
Right.
And even Fox was doing some type of dancing around that they were not really on his benefit.
They never really were on board.
No, they were never on board. And the only one who was on board, though, was Hannity and sometimes O'Reilly.
But, I mean, the media even let us believe that if there was a Trump, if Trump was elected, that the markets would crash. It would be the Great Depression. The exact opposite happened. They initially dropped slightly, and then the markets have gone crazy. And by the grace of God, the last few days have been very prosperous for those who invest in the market.
And did you hear China and Putin, and I believe even Mexico, have already written Donald Trump saying they want to work together?
Yeah.
The country's never seen anything like it since the day Ronald Reagan was elected.
All the thing is,
this is superior to Ronald Reagan.
Go ahead, Doc.
This is even better than Ronald Reagan, not only because Ronald Reagan was still a politician, he still needs to float between some ideas, but this man comes with a tremendous amount of business knowledge and very forceful. So I do believe that this is the blessing for America. When I woke up the day after the election, I look at the sky and was bright. And I felt like somebody removed shackles from my legs and hands because I felt free. I already saw again, America has again the opportunity to have the dream, the opportunity, the business, and shine like everyone who comes to America think that this is the only place in the world where you have the opportunity to be yourself. Mm-hmm. And I thought that we're robbing us for the people who lives in the country and the people who will come to the country trying to be Americans.
But here's the thing, Jeff touched on something when he said that it was a lot of depression. They thought the world was going to tailspin into a depression. The depression I saw were some liberal teachers that were crying because they didn't know how to tell the children. I thought, well, maybe if you didn't disparage Trump, you wouldn't have so much double talking to do now.
Well, the world is all...
The only depression I see are the liberals going, how could it happen to us? Mm-hmm. Boo-hoo. And then they're lighting fires everywhere because, you know, those are just peaceful protest.
That's such a great demonstration of love Trump's hate.
And right, exactly. Yeah. Hey, Kimberly, listen, we're out of time. I know you're probably going to hang around for our affiliate segment, right? Correct?
Will do.
All right, so I'm going to put you on hold. We'll be back with you and a lot more to talk about, of course. Saying goodbye to our affiliate station WFLA in Tampa and continuing on next with more talk of the election. Stick around. It's American Medicine Today.
Revolutionary in his field, Dr. Bonati created, perfected, and patented the Bonati Spine procedures. Using his genius, Bonati invented precise tools necessary to minimize surgery, scarring, anesthesia, and recovery. So successful are the Bonati Spine procedures, they consistently reflect 98.75% patient satisfaction. 50,000 successful procedures have been performed exclusively at our location. Over half our patients have suffered from failed back and neck surgeries at other facilities. Bonati succeeds where others fail.
You're listening to American Medicine Today, presented by the Bonati Spine Institute, featuring the internationally acclaimed inventor of the Bonati Spine procedures, Alfred Bonati, MD. Once again, here are Dr. Bonati and your host, Kimberly Vermel.
Thank you for listening to American Medicine Today. No, I am not Kimberly Bermel. I am Ethan Uecker, joined by Mr. Jeff Wagstaff.
Yes, I am.
And world-renowned orthopedic surgeon, Dr. Alfred Bonati. How are you doing, Doc?
Hi.
And speaking of Kimberly Bermel, that one is in, what is Hawaii? Like, the Aloha State, that's what it's called. She's hanging out in the Aloha State. How's it going, Kimberly?
Yeah. Talking to you live from Lanai. How about that?
Wow. How's the weather?
Yeah. It's beautiful. I'm swinging on a hammock out here.
A hurricane is coming.
I think it's a typhoon,
it'll
right?
Be a typhoon on
it'll
that
be
side.
A typhoon in the Pacific, but you get the idea.
No. You want to know something, though?
No, we don't.
As I'm here, we do, because guess what? Everyone's protesting everywhere else, and they're burning down our votes. And here,
nothing.
In Hawaii, it is so peaceful, so beautiful. People haven't lost their minds. They're not depressed.
Did Trump win Hawaii? Does anybody know? I'm guessing probably not.
No, he lost.
It's a pretty...
I don't think he did, but guess what?
It's a socialistic place. Pouting. That's why they're so quiet.
There's no pouting.
Nobody's
there's
there.
No crying. There's no
everybody's
despair.
Migrating.
There's nobody protesting in Hawaii or Florida because it's simply too beautiful to protest.
That's true.
And guess what? I think I actually see a rainbow.
Wow, look at that. It's a promise of a new day to make America
it
great
is.
Again.
Yes.
Somewhere.
Are you going to walk to the end of the rainbow?
I'll find my pot of gold.
That's right.
I was going to say, if you bring me anything back from Hawaii, I'll take that little pot of gold at the end of the rainbow.
That would be nice.
Oh, Kimberly, I'm sorry, but I dropped your car last night and I crashed it.
Oh. Well, that's okay. I'm sure the replacement vehicle will be equally as wonderful.
Just as nice. Yeah.
I don't think so. Maybe a Kia.
Doc, here's the amazing thing. People don't know. Doc is an incredible surgeon.
Mm-hmm.
But he has been known to...
Get a few fender benders? A
couple fender benders, huh, Doc?
No comment.
I've been urging him to take my truck. You want to borrow my truck? Yeah. Take it for the weekend.
Just roll over people.
I don't understand this. I never had an accident. Is Kimberly the one who has the accidents?
Kimberly does, too. That's for sure. But wasn't it you, Doc, that wrecked one of the reason Kimberly has the car she has now? Didn't you wreck it? I don't think it was your fault, but didn't you get
no,
in an accident?
No, she gave me a car, never told me that it didn't have brakes.
Oh,
she was trying
that's
to kill
so
you.
Not true.
Yeah, she was trying to kill you, Doc.
And she goes, but I'm telling you, okay, I told you to don't drive this car. And I say, you didn't tell me that you have a car without brakes.
Oh, we actually, it was funny. It was going to be repaired and he didn't want to be in the nice car, so he took
now,
mine.
Now I know why every time that she tried to reach the red light, opened the door and put her heels back.
It's like the Flintstone car. That's what.
Well, hold on, though. So Doc was being a gentleman. If your car was unsafe, he was being a gentleman and driving your car to keep you safe.
To take the risk.
I told him. I don't think so.
That was not a reason.
All the safety features. Yeah.
Something else.
But it wasn't his fault. I do have to say that. Somebody else blew through a stop sign and a red light.
That's true.
Yep.
And I had a concussion and a whiplash and a broken knee and
snoring
and broken. From that time on, I snore.
Dr. Bonati, don't worry about it. I know a guy that can help you.
Yeah. His name is Dr.
No, I don't think so.
So listen, guys, wrapping up the show here, we definitely have some time to chat about this. I know Doc wanted to continue talking about the Trump victory. Anything that hasn't been said, although, you know what, I had a thought. You kept bringing up your solution to the protesting and this and that was to reinstitute the draft, right, Doc?
Absolutely, absolutely. It's just an incredible benefit for these totally uneducated, unprepared individuals that they are disturbing the peace. Mm-hmm. If you grab all these people and put them on some type of a military training, and you are going to bring individuals to society that are going to be helpful, and they're going to be proud, and they're going to do good things. If you don't, you're going to have all these type of hippie, crappy individuals that they walk around there dirty, without home, and
barefoot,
with food stamps and
smoking weed.
Smoking weed and all this garbage.
Wearing tie-dye.
Well, listen. I bring it up again because I had a thought during our last break after you talked about it last, and I'm glad you mentioned hippies because that's part of it. Back in the 60s during Vietnam, there was a draft.
Yes.
Right? But there were still tons and tons of protesting because people who were in college, am I right? If you were in college at the time, you didn't have to. You were excluded from the draft.
Exactly. A lot of people went to college. And that's the people who, the same thing that's happening now, is that people who really doesn't have responsibility is the people who create the problem. Mm-hmm. Now, if you draft everybody, then you will go, it's not going to be a problem.
Well, I think what you want to say and what you want instituted isn't necessarily a draft. It's kind of like what they have in Israel, where it's a mandatory military service.
Yes.
Everyone has to serve at least 1 year or whatever.
Women or men, they go and they serve on the military, and you are going to change totally the way and the perception of the country, the respect for the country, the respect for the elderly, the respect for education, the respect for the children, all this garbage that is happening today in the country. I mean, are you thinking there's going to be, oh, it's okay to have one bathroom for everybody? Mm. No. In the military, you don't have that. You need to have a type of a responsibility of your actions. Mm-hmm. And if you do that, then when you go in society, you behave with respect. Mm-hmm. And the other thing that we need to do is we need to protect our vets. When the vets come to the country, they need to be protected because these people not only serve to the country, but at the same time, they have injuries that they need to be attended to. Mm-hmm. And instead to do that, all this behavior of irresponsibility is being carried in every level of the politics.
You brought up an excellent point, Ethan. When you mention Israel, mm-hmm. we could learn a lot from the public service that every Israeli performs. And also, we could learn a lot from the Israelis on how they treat their veterans. Mm-hmm. They don't have these issues. And as you were speaking, I realized something. We live here in an area that's not under attack. We're attacked by ISIS from far away, mm-hmm. but we're not under attack every day. Think about the differences.
Only from the peaceful protesters.
Yeah, it's all about the love.
But we are absolutely under attack. We're under attack by poor sports, sour grapes, people that can't quite handle what's been going on.
But those poor Israeli people are surrounded by enemies.
They're never going to be part of it.
Agreed.
Different perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Well, but that's a different thing. That is a defense mechanism. That's why they institute that one. We need to create the same type of responsibility here because we maybe are not being attacked by enemies from outside, but we are being attacked by enemies from inside. And these enemies from inside is how the countries lose the battle mm-hmm. because you have inside cancer. And the Democratic Party is a cancer for this society. And we'll end destroying the country unless we make a very clear responsibility. You respect the flag. There should be a law that they say you do not disrespect the flag. I don't care why. I saw on television one individual with a Mexican flag covering his body and burning the American flag. I'm telling you, if I see something like that, I will kick his butt, man.
They'll kick his burritos right back across the border.
See you later. Exactly.
Doc, something.
It all goes back to united we stand, divided we fall. Come on, folks.
Exactly. Well, hey, listen, that'll do it for the show. We are out of time. Kimberly, hang up the phone. Enjoy your time in Hawaii. What are you doing? Why are you calling the show? Enjoy yourself.
I'm trying to recover. I was so sick at the thought that Hillary would get in that it just took over. And now that Trump's in, I think I'm starting to feel a little bit better.
A little bit better.
You're seeing a new light.
Yeah. I never doubt.
In Lanai, just to let you guys know, in Lanai, they were hit very hard with Obama's economy.
Oh, yeah.
And many of the jobs left this area and went to another island. So I have big hopes that Donald Trump will,
Why don't you ask how many of those people are Democrats?
All right. But either way, Democrat, Republican alike, if Trump can do it, they're going to be thrilled.
That's right.
And for everybody listening, we know
that it'll be Trump continued 2020.
Jeff.
For everybody listening,
2040.
We know you have a lot of choices on your radio dial. And if you're watching on the stream, we want to thank you. Whether you just tuned in today, you tune in every week, you listen for a few minutes, you listen the entire hour. We genuinely appreciate and are very thankful that you've tuned into the program. Thank you for listening. Yep. God bless you.
We're talking about how envy we are.
All right.
They can rid you of all your pain.
That's right. All right, Kimberly, we'll talk to you later.
Kimberly, these guys are Democrats. Right, they were talking bad about you, and now they're just kissing you.
She can't hear you. I just hung up on her. Hey, if you have back pain, neck pain, sciatic pain, migraines, give a call to the Bonati Spine Institute, 855-267-0482, 855-267-0482. Visit Bonati.com. We are out of here. Enjoy your weekend.
We'll holler at you.
Revolutionary in his field, Dr. Bonati created, perfected, and patented the Bonati Spine procedures. Using his genius, Bonati invented precise tools necessary to minimize surgery, scarring, anesthesia, and recovery. So successful are the Bonati Spine procedures, they consistently reflect 98.75% patient satisfaction. 50,000 successful procedures have been performed exclusively at our location. Over half our patients have suffered from failed back and neck surgeries at other facilities. Bonati succeeds where others fail.